Praise the Lord. God bless you. It's so good to be with you this Sunday morning. We just bring you greetings from Christian Heritage Worship Center here in Pineville, North Carolina. We're so glad to have you with us this morning. Bless the Lord. Join me in opening prayer and let's invite the Lord into this service. Father, we just thank you this morning, Lord, for a wonderful new day that you allowed us to see, Lord. God, where there's new mercies, Lord, a new grace, Lord, for us this day. We praise you, Lord, because you are merciful, because you are great, because you are the Almighty God. We love you this morning, Lord God. We count it a privilege to come together as a corporate body, Lord, to praise you and magnify your name. You are our sanctifier, our healer, our keeper, our preserver, Lord. You provided for us, Lord. We're just so happy, Lord, to be children of the Most High God. We invite you into this service, Lord God. We say, Lord, just have your way. Touch the ears and the eyes of those that are looking on and listening, Lord God, that they may hear what the Spirit of God is saying and see what the Spirit of God is trying to show them, Lord God, this day in Jesus' name. All that agree, say amen and amen. Bless the Lord. Join me in the reading of the Word. Turn with me to Isaiah, the 12th chapter. I'm reading from the Christian Standard Bible. And it reads, on that day, you will say, I will give thanks to you, Lord. Although you were angry with me, your anger has turned away and you have comforted me. Indeed, God is my salvation. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord himself is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. You will joyfully draw water from the springs of salvation. And on that day, you will say, give thanks to the Lord. Proclaim his name. Make his works known among the peoples. Declare that his name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known throughout the earth. Cry out and sing, city of Zion, for the Holy One of Israel is among you in his greatness. May the Lord just add a blessing to the reading of his word, and may it just stay with us and resonate in our spirits and bring him glory throughout this week. God bless you. Join us in praise and worship. Come along and sing with us.
The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Of whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait. promise of the Lord.
And services with the Pure Arts to receive today's message.
Come with an open heart and an obedient spirit. God will meet you where you're at.
May the spirit of revelation, knowledge, and the power of the Holy Spirit reside in you and in our souls.
Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. From the book of Genesis in chapter 28, we'll begin the message. The subtitle for the message is, Where Do You Live? The subtitle for the message, Where Do You Live? Our Jacob's Ladder. Jacob was one of a set of twins. There were two sets of twins that I can recall right away. Phares and Zero were one. Phares, of course, went on to be in the kingly line. In other words, his great, 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 great grandson was Jesus. Can I say it to you that way? Okay, so there was another set of twins. We're talking about the day that was Esau and Jacob. We know they were twins because Jacob was named for an act that he did when Esau was separated. First, he reached out of the womb and did what? Grabbed his heel. I don't know how you got your name, but that's a way to name somebody, isn't it? He was called the heel grasper. That's what his name literally means. So if you take away Jacob and just say he'll grasp, well, you'll have problems in school, wouldn't you? You know, kids are not kind in school when you got funny names. But Jacob was a schemer. He later was schemed by his uncle Laban when he went to work for his wife. He had to work for his wife, the one he wanted, for not 7 years, but 14 years. And here he's fleeing because he had stolen the birthright from his brother. He and his mother conspired to do this. This is Rebekah. You remember the story. Rebekah conspired, ended up, Jacob left, and she never saw her son again. She died without seeing him when Jacob separated from them. And so we hear in this story, Jacob is contemplating rejoining, and eventually he does. And it's interesting the way he does this. Everything that he didn't care about, he sent ahead to meet Esau first in case something happened to them and he could flee. Oh, yeah, he was a schemer. We are talking about him today. In spite of the fact that he was a schemer, the blessing of God rested on him. Now, this lets you know the difference between nature and God's grace. See, nature is what we think ought to happen. God's grace will cross the hands on you and cause the blessing to go another way, a way that you would not have chosen. Many of you understand that today because you're not where you should be, and you got out of a lot of stuff that you should have gone because of God's grace. He made another way for you when in fact you deserve something worse. Now I'm talking to you, so I'm standing first in the line. I know it's a lot of stuff I got by and really didn't get by, but my point is God's grace made the difference for me. We'll see this happening today. In the book of Genesis, chapter 28, is that where we were? Verse 10, we're beginning. Jacob went out from Beersheba. Beersheba is in South Israel. When he talks about from Dan to Beersheba, it's giving you from north down to south. It's 150 miles, 75 miles across, about the size of New Jersey is Israel. And he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set, and took of the stones of that place. He didn't have the pillow man then. You know who I'm talking about. The pillow man. Didn't have that. He was in the desert. He took a stone. He put them up for his pillows and lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth. You see why they call it Jacob's ladder. Yeah, this occurred, Jacob, and the top of it reached to heaven, and behold, the angels of God ascending and what? Descending on that. Can you get a picture of that? Here he's on the earth, sleeping on a pillow. He dreams, sees this ladder from earth to heaven, and he sees the angels of God ascending and descending on this ladder. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, the God of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. Out of all the stuff he did, he's going to give him this stuff. Thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth. Thou shalt spread abroad to the west, to the east, to the north, to the south. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with thee, and I will keep thee in all the places whither thou goest. Will bring thee again into this land, for I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of. And Jacob awaked out of his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place. I don't know if you had one of those dreams that wrench you, man, that you can't forget. He had one of those dreams. He said, the Lord is in this place, and I didn't know it. He goes on to say, and he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? There's none other than the house of God. In the Hebrew, it says Bethel, literally house of God, Bethel. We have a lot of churches named Bethel today, don't we? Bethel Missionary Baptist, Primitive Baptist, Bethel, there's a lot of Bethels. In every denomination, there's a Bethel because it means house of God. It has a significance here. And to the story, we see it coming to pass here. And so he said he was afraid. How dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. Joseph rose up early in the morning, took the stone that he had put for his pillow, set it up for a pillow, poured oil on top of it, made an altar pretty much, and he called the name of the place Bethel. Called it Bethel. Another place in Scripture. You find that the house of God is important, but the God of the house of God. That is the name of our church, El Bethel. It literally means the God of the house of God. I talk to people sometime, and I was talking to a friend in South Africa, and I was telling him, I said, look, man, what about church? He said, church couldn't do anything for me. I said, what about the God of the church? I'm still waiting for that answer. Still waiting for that answer. Because we don't have to deal with the house. We have to deal with the God. You can ride all by it, but you can't ride by him. One of these days, that's going to be over. Is that right? Come on and say amen. It's true. Gate of heaven. He called the place Bethel, but the name of the city was called Luz at the first. He vowed a vow. Listen to this vow. You can see the tricks there, all strewn in here. He's strewn in here. He said, if God will be with me. Now, he already said he's going to be with him. But he's still propositioning. He still thinks he can proposition God. If God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God. Now, here's a human propositioning God. Is that what you hear? That's what I read here. We think we have that privilege. God has already blessed him. Isaac commanded the blessing on him and told Esau, I've already blessed who I'm going to bless. Even though he got it by trickery and chicanery, the blessing would rest on Jacob. And this stone, which I have set for a pillow, shall be God's house. And of all that thou shalt give me, I will surely give the tenth unto thee. We say that carefully because we need to have people to understand that tithing has nothing to do with law. Law hadn't even come yet. Abraham tithed in Genesis 13. We see Jacob tithing here. We won't go too far with that. You know, y'all can't bear that. We're going from there to the book of John. St. John, chapter 1. I'm going to try to connect these two scriptures. So as you see what happens here. Now, this is the scripture that talks about Yohanan, Hadmat Bean. This is John the Baptist. This is him now on the scene. We went to the place about where he was baptizing in Bethabara, which is out from Jericho, east toward Jordan. And so we were actually visually at the place where the Messiah, Jesus, would come. And, of course, John would baptize him here. Verse 29 says, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is the one of whom I said, after me cometh the man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. Now, John and Jesus were cousins. Is that right? 6 months he was here before the Messiah came, before he was born. And so here, he was the one that introduced the world to the Messiah, the one who baptized Jesus. Just imagine the great honor that was for him. Verse 35, and again the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking up upon Jesus as he walked, he saith, behold, the Lamb of God. This is John speaking of the Messiah. And of course, at this point, his disciples begin to leave. In other words, to not be joined to John, but join themselves to the Messiah, to Jesus. And looking upon Jesus after saying that, in verse 37, and the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. Going on, it says, then Jesus turned and saw them following and said unto them, What seek ye? Now, just to ask you a question. If you ran into, how many of you have run into a famous person at some point? Yeah, you were in their company. You happened to be in the crowd and they were there. Or maybe you had a chance to have an audience with them. What would you say to a person that you were seeing in this circumstance? In other words, you saw whoever your person that you care about, whether it's Robbie Zacharias or T.D. Jakes or maybe a rapper. In other words, you're in their presence. And all of a sudden, it's difficult to think about what to say. You know, we don't have any problem talking to our friends, but we don't really want to appear too unlearned or foolish in front of somebody who's famous. And so we guard what we have to say. You have to ask yourself, what in the world would you say to someone like that? And if you read on down, you see the disciples facing him for the first time. They saith unto him, Rabbi, which is to say being interpreted, Master, where do you live? Rabbi, where do you live? Now that saying is destined to change their lives forever. The scripture says, does it not? Jesus says, foxes have holes, the birds have nests. He said, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. Can you guess what's getting ready to happen here? As they ask him, where do you live? And he saith unto them, verse 39, come and see. And they came and saw where he dwelt and abode with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour from 6 o'clock in the morning. 6 hours takes you up to 12 and 4 more hours takes you to 4 o'clock in the afternoon, approximately. One of the two which heard John speak followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon, saith unto him, we have found the Messiah, being interpreted to Christ. Now you have to ask yourself, what in the world did they see that convinced them they had found the one? Can you understand that? I mean, if I ask somebody to come home with me, they're not going to say I'm the Messiah when they come back. They might have had some good chicken or something like that. But they wouldn't ask. They wouldn't say that I'm the Messiah. So you wonder, what in the world did they see that so transformed them? These men would eventually go to the entire world with this gospel. Think about that. We have found the Messiah. And let's see, go back up to where it says, we have found the Messiah. Verse 42, and he brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, he said unto Peter, now, he said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. This is without an introduction. He wouldn't need to be introduced to him. Simon Bar-Jonas, a son of Jonas, thou shalt be called Cephas, which is being by interpretation of stone. The following day, Jesus would go forth into Galilee, find that Philip saith unto him, Lech Acharai. In Hebrew, it means, come, follow me. Come, follow me. He said that to many of them. Now, Philip was of Bethsaida, city of Andrew and Peter. Philip findeth Nathanael. His other name is Bartholomew. He finds Nathanael. Saith unto him, we have found him. We have found him of whom Moses and the law and the prophets did write. Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Nathanael said unto him, because he knew during that time, I've been to Nazareth. Nazareth is a sprawling city now, but there's a compound, a Catholic compound, that's kind of in the middle of the center of it. And the guides tell us that compound was the size of Nazareth in Jesus' day. So it was a very small place. And so Nathanael could not imagine that a person so great in Scripture that Moses spoke of would be born in a small place like that. That place would not be worthy for him. You get that? See that from the text here. And Nathanael saith unto him, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Philip saith unto him, come and see. Verse 47 goes on. It says, Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and saith unto him, he read his mail. He said, behold an Israelite in whom there is no guile or no hiding of sin. In other words, Nathaniel was so committed to truth that he lived a life consistent with that truth. Jesus saw that in him and pronounced it to him. Nathaniel, shocked at that, asked, Nathaniel said unto him, whence knowest thou me? Jesus answered and said unto him, this came crushing down on him. He said, behold, before that Philip called thee, when thou wast under the fig tree, I saw thee. Nathaniel had a place of prayer that was private and away from prying eyes. There was only one person he was talking to in that place, the God that he served. And unbeknownst to him, eyes were upon him that he did not see and was not aware of. This same God now addressed him. Before you were called, when you were under the fig tree, I saw thee. Now you can tell the impact this had upon Nathaniel by what he said in answer to this. He said, Nathaniel answered him and says, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God. Thou art the King of Israel. Thou art the King of Israel. And Jesus answered and said unto him, because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, thou believest. Now thou shalt see greater things than these. And now he then utters these words that connect the testaments. He then says to him, or them, verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter you shall see the heavens open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Jacob's ladder was standing in front of him. Jacob's ladder was standing right in front of him. It was no longer the Lord that was in heaven standing above it. He was standing now on the earth. That's right. And the angels of God were ascending and descending upon him. The gate of heaven was now in front of him. No longer in a fixed place somewhere else where Jacob was on a pillar somewhere. But wherever Jesus is, the gate of heaven is there. El Bethel. The God of the house of God was now standing in their midst. They didn't have to go find the pillar. They didn't have to search for El Bethel. El Bethel was in front of them. He was the Lord. Angels of God attending to his abode. That's right. He was there. And so, what is the answer to the question? Where do you live? Where does the Master, where does the Savior live? And that's a fairly easy question, I think, with an easy answer. He dwells with his heavenly Father. I can't give you the specifics of what happened and what transformed them. I do know in Scripture that he transfigured himself before three of the disciples. Remember, he was glistening white. Moses and Elijah came and what? Joined with him. That was a transformative experience for John, Peter, and the disciples that were there. That was transformative because they saw something they had never seen before. And they wanted to build three tabernacles. One for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for him. They said, of course not. But they found out where he lived. He dwells with his heavenly Father. Now here's the real kicker to the whole thing. At least it is to me. What happens then, since we don't have to look for El Bethel, he is with us wherever we are. wherever we pray, wherever we get on our knees, wherever disciples join together hands. He said, where two or three gather together, I am what? In the midst. He says that he leads us to know him, that any place is potentially the gate of heaven because Jesus will be there. But what happens when he lives inside of you? What happens when the pillar that became the Messiah now lives inside you? Paul says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. You get what I'm saying here? This is quite. Whether the disciples fully understood it or not, a thundering message was given when Jesus spoke these words to Nathanael. He staked the claim. Were they aware that the Lord who fashioned the heavens and the earth was standing beside them? Angelic host, attended his abode. Even at that, we struggle to word it precisely. The word abode immediately brings to mind the concepts of residing and the boundaries, neither of which is a fitting term for the one who is without beginning and is omnipresent. Jacob found out that God's presence to bless could transform any location into the house of God. Now the disciples learned the same. They were inclined to judge Jesus by his earthly fathers, Joseph the carpenter. They were trying to measure his worth by his earthly home, Nazareth. He opened up to them the truth that any earthly setting at which he is present becomes the gateway to heaven. Think of the power of that. The gateway of heaven. What comfort this must have brought them. Their lives would change beyond their wildest dreams, so that one day they will leave everyone, mother, father, children, whatever, and they will give their lives, spill their lives for the gospel. If you marvel at what I have shown you of yourself, Nathanael, this is only the beginning of what awaits you when I disclose my glory to you. This is marvelous in our eyes. I hope today you see the connection between Genesis 28, Jacob's ladder, who has become now our Jacob's ladder. We now access him in our prayers, on our knees, Bible study, whatever, and we don't have to go to Israel to find El Bethel or to find Bethel. We have him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for Jesus and for his love. We thank you, Lord, for the truth and the power of the truth in Scripture, Lord, to enlighten and to draw us in, to bring us close, Lord, to you. That closeness we desire with our Heavenly Father, Lord. It is a hunger that we've hosted and we've had in our bodies for a long time to find what is truth. How do I connect with the one who knows the most about me? The one who, in spite of knowing everything about me, still loves me and still makes a way in his word for me. Lord, I thank you for that. A million times I thank you for reaching down and touching me and bringing me into a knowledge of the truth. We bless you. We thank you for all that you do. We pray it. And for those, Lord, who need to know you and those who want to extend their hand, their hearts to you, I pray that they would ask you, just simply ask you, Jesus, I know you died for my sins. Come into my life and touch me, save me right now. If you pray a prayer like that, similar to that, just pour your heart out to God and just ask him to touch you, to save you, to rescue you. Wherever you are, you could be on the highest mountain enjoying wealth and success, still be empty inside. You could be in the deepest valley where seemingly no one passes by you without kicking you. He can touch you there as well. and bring a warmth to your heart that you have not experienced. I am a witness of that. I thank you, Lord, for doing it, for touching us. We pray in Jesus' name, and the people of God said amen. God bless you. By that I mean, depending on which church you are in, their ordinations go a little bit differently. In other words, some ordain elders as we do, some ordain ministers, some ordain pastors. We currently do not ordain pastors or elders. You will ascend to that, and there are a couple of ways to do that in our church, but it's a little bit different. So what you'll see today is two elder elects in Lady Perrine Arrington, Lady Angela Morris, and then the ordination of a pastor in pastor-elect, Taya Denise Cruz. And the way this will be handled is that what I would do is to give the charge to the candidates, all three at the same time. After that, we will have you to stand, and then we will charge you as the congregants. And then after you sit down, then we will actually go through the formal anointing with oil and the pronouncement upon them so that you see that. Once we complete that, we will present some documents to them that basically say in writing what just took place. In other words, pastor or elder, you have those documents. Once we do that, so that you'll get an idea, what we would do is have them a turnaround. We'll have what a fellowship played and sung. And then what we have you to do is to stand up and come around. Would you just kindly move quickly through? In other words, shake their hand or pat them on the back and so forth. But we don't want you to stand up and have a conversation with them. Does that make sense? Because we want to go, we want to get out of here before dinner, before lunch. Okay. So we'll go through that now. And this is a very important time for us. And so we want to, thank you. We want to make sure that this goes well. Feed the flock of God, which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being in samples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another and be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud, giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. God has spoken gracefully through his church and the bishops, calling you to provide leadership to the church and assist in tending his sheep. Upon your qualifications, as witnessed by the bishop's council, you are being certified forthwith to assume the responsibilities of pastor and elder. Here is the charge to each of you, and I'll actually tender the responses so you don't have to do anything but repeat what I'm saying. Will you serve Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Your response, with God's help, we will. A little louder. There you go. Will you teach and model for others the gospel of Christ? Your response, with God's help, we will. Will you ensure the healthy teaching that strengthens the Lord's people? Your response, with God's help, we will. Will you guide God's people patiently and prayerfully? Your response? Will you lean on the Spirit of God as you, did I just say it? Or will you lean on the Spirit of God as you equip the church for acts of faithfulness? Your response? Will you mentor by example the other leaders God gives to the church? Your response? Will you lead as a church rather than appease us, resolving to keep us focused on God's purposes? Your response? Will you pray for us when we are sick, minister to us when we are hurting, and rejoice with us when we are blessed? Your response? Will you work in harmony with your fellow? Finally, will you be great among us by serving humbly as Christ did? Your response? Now, we need a charge not only from the candidates, but also from those who they will have charge over. Meaning that the elders in the supervisory positions they have, pastor obviously is the chief supervisor for the flock. And so what I'm going to do, here's some scriptures. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for this is unprofitable for you. Church, our worship today confesses our belief that God has called these ladies as elders and pastors to our congregations. Our actions from this point forward ought to reflect that belief, and it requires commitment on all our parts. So let me have you to stand together, please. Let me practice, if you know the response. With God's help, we will. Okay, you got it. You say that about 4 or 5 times, we'll be there. Will you follow these ladies in service for the sake of Christ? Your response? Beautiful. Will you be respectful of their leadership and imitate their faith? Your response? Will you support them in prayer and serve them in peace? Your response? Will you lift up their arms even as they care for our souls? Your response? Will you do all of this knowing that it pleases the Lord and shows the world the perfection of his ways? Your response? Jesus was an example to those that he was over. In other words, while he was on the earth, one of the examples was he washed the disciples' feet. Now, while we would not have you to engage that today in this place, we thought it would be nice to have some examples. And so what we have are towels for you, and embroidered on those towels, woman of God. We have three that are here. And so what I like to do is to present these three. Lady Angela, Lady Perrine, and to Pastille Taylor. And now we get to that part where we now will anoint and then pray for those. I'm going to ask Bishop Joe to join me. He has a presentation that he wants to present at this point. You want to afterwards? Okay, that's great. Then we will come down. Okay, I'm going to actually use it right now. Okay. This is the oil of joy, you might say. We're going to anoint Lady Angela. And we anoint with oil. And so we're not going to drench her, not this time. But we will let the oil flow on her. There it is. There it is. Father, I bless you for your goodness and your mercies shown us. All of our lives, Lord, you have been there. Even when we were not cognizant of the fact you were here. I now ordain Lady Angela Morris, in the name of the Father and of the Son, Jesus, and of the Holy Ghost, preach the word in season, out of season. Show full proof of your ministry. Hallelujah. We bless you. We thank you for your goodness and your mercies, Lord. May she minister well and fulfill all that you command her to fulfill. In the church of Jesus Christ, we pray. People of God, say amen. my sister, we lay hands upon you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. I ordain you elder in the church of God. Preach the word in season, out of season. Make full proof of your ministry. Teach, encourage, strengthen the saints. We bless you right now. We ask, Lord, that you fulfill everything. May you hear his voice one day, say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. We bless you, elder.
For the foundations of the world, chosen by Jesus before you were born, chosen by the Lord. We thank you, Heavenly Father, right now, because as she was chosen by you, now being equipped and set apart for your service. We thank you, Holy Spirit, because you're here and on her. And the anointing that removes burdens and destroy yokes would be upon her. May the wisdom of God be upon you. In the name of Jesus Christ, as you go forth to preach the word and pitch the word and be transformed by the word and be sanctified by the word, may the Holy Spirit empower you as you lay hands on the sick, as you cast out demons, as you make disciples of all men, as Jesus have sent us, so we send you to do and to fulfill the kingdom of God. Now may that anointing be upon you. You are hereby now ordained and separated for this cause. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, we send you out. We send you to do what Jesus did, to continue what Jesus did. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen and amen. This is your Bible. Preach it. Study it. It will transform your life. This is what it takes to transform. The word transform. Not what others say. Not by religion. Not by philosophy. But let the word of God do it. It is the power of God unto salvation. God bless you.
Thank you for joining us and allowing us in your home.
It indeed was our honor to bring the word of God to you today. May it grow in you richly, strengthen and encourage you.
May the Lord be with you throughout this week. Shalom.
Hello, and thank you for being part of this ministry. One part of our worship that we are excited about is to worship the Lord with the returning of our tithes and planting a seed as an offering to the Lord. We know that this is not a debt that we owe, but a seed that we sow. It leaves our hands, but never our lives. It goes into our future and multiplies 1,000 times more. Please take a moment to return your tithes and plant your seed as your expression of love and thanks to the Lord as we worship Him with our gifts. you may do so by going to the Giverify app and typing in Christian Heritage Worship Center, Pineville, North Carolina. God bless.
Grace and peace, friends. Thank you so much for joining us today for our experience of worship and the Word. We hope that your heart was encouraged and lifted up, and we pray that as you're mixing this Word with faith, that you will see the promises of God being made manifest in your life. On behalf of Bishop Clive and Lady Cynthia Joe, again, we want to say thank you. Thank you for your support, and thank you for joining us as we continue to do life together. We would love to connect with you even after the message is over. Feel free to visit us on our website, www.christianheritageworshipcenter.org. And if you would like to email us, you can do so at info@christianheritageworshipcenter.org. Find us on Instagram at chwc.pineville.nc. And on Facebook, just search under Christian Heritage Worship Center. Until we join again together, we want to say thank you again, and we pray God's continued blessing upon your life. Shalom.